You're watching Power Talk on your community TV station, UHF TV 33, Detroit Highland Park.
Program does not reflect the views and opinions of Channel 33, its management, or sponsors.
The Lakeshore Church of Christ of Southhaven, Michigan announces a religious debate, Christian versus Muslim, Bible versus Quran. Preacher Holger Neubauer versus the leader and teacher of the new nation of Islam, the Son of Man, May 7th at the Foundry Hall in Southhaven, Michigan, located at 422 Eagle Street. Doors will open at 1 p.m. This debate is scheduled to last from 2 p.m. to 6 p.m. For further information, call 313-868-0000 or 269-325-4449. Remember that, May 7th, in Southhaven, Michigan, the Foundry Hall, a great debate between preacher Holger Neubauer and the leader and teacher of the new nation of Islam, the Son of Man.
We can be sure.
Okay, well, I just told you that it's a lot of people come into the world, and at one time when I was a child, I understood as a child, and you couldn't tell me that Santa Claus didn't bring me my toys. I believed and I was sure.
When I was a child, I thought I was a child.
Well, that's what I'm telling you. The same thing that holds true with a physical child in the natural childhood, that's the same thing with spiritual childhood. We believe a lot of things that we were taught by the religious people of this world, but they taught us wrong. And the very proof that they taught us wrong is that they got all these religions going here. Look, it's just like when you go to
1 Corinthians 11:19. Well, I'll show you why there are false religions. Let me show you. Got nothing to do with a missing...
Well, if you agreed with me, why'd you cut me off?
I want to show you why. No, I don't agree with you as far as why the religions are here.
You just agreed that they're false religions.
Yes, but not why. The reason that they have them is that God would demonstrate who is following the truth. Look at 1 Corinthians 11, verse 19.
Well, how are you going to know who's following the truth?
Thy word is truth. The Bible says, come let us reason together. No truth is of a lie. Someone can tell whether or not you're preaching by the oracles of God. The Bible says, when you read, you may understand my knowledge in the mystery of Christ. Ephesians 3, verse 4. I want you to notice the text here.
The mystery of God was not to be revealed until I got here.
That's not so. It was
just
revealed.
Just a moment. Just a moment. Over here in the book of Revelation.
Well, here's the reason our heresy. Let's put this point first, and we'll go on over there. 1 Corinthians 11:19. Paul said, there must also be heresies among you, that they which are approved may be made manifest among you. You want to know why all of these false religions? That those who have the truth can be made manifest. So if I'm looking for the truth, and Jesus said, I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it, and I can't read about the Catholic Church, I'm not going to follow a Catholic church. If I can't read about a Baptist church in here, I'm not going to follow a Baptist church or a Methodist church. The Bible says the churches of Christ salutes you, Romans 16:16. I'll show you the church where we belong in the Bible. And I'm not over the church. I'm part of the body. Jesus is the head. And he is the head of the church. And he's the savior of the body, Ephesians 5, verse 23. That's why, good minister, look here now. That's why, minister, that we have divisions, so God would manifest those who have the truth. That's why.
Okay, now the prophecy in Revelation is that the mystery of God wouldn't be finished until the seventh angel sounded. This is in the 10th chapter of Revelation, and it says, and I saw another mighty angel, meaning messenger, come down from heaven, clothed with a cloud. Remember, and they say he cometh with clouds?
Yes.
Okay. Clothed with a cloud, and a rainbow was upon his head. Now, we know that physical clouds is physical water vapor. But the Bible is a spiritual book. And Jesus, when he met the woman at the well, he told her, he said, give me something to drink. And she said, You know, thou being, she thought he wasn't supposed to have no dealing with her because she was a Samaritan and she thought he was a Jew. And so Jesus...
He was a Jew.
No, he wasn't. But that's another...
John 4:9.
Just a moment. Okay. Just a moment. And so Jesus told her, he said, if you knew the gift of God and who it is that asked you for water, you would have asked him for living water, and he would have given you living water wherein you would have thirst no more. Mm-hmm. And she told him, she said, Lord, give me this water. I'm tired of coming back and forth to this well.
That's true.
And but she didn't understand that Jesus was talking about
spiritually
the word. The word is water, and it is spiritual water, because it's just like you and I, when we are struggling, trying to get an understanding of a mathematical equation. It's the same as a man that's thirsty after a drink that would quench his thirst physically, because nothing quenches your thirst for the answer to that problem, but the true answer and how you arrive at it. And once you've been given it, then you all of a sudden become a well out of which that water can come.
4:9. Go back to 4:9.
Now, when the book says he come with clouds, then the holy scriptures are spiritual clouds because it's stored up water vapor. It's stored up knowledge that came from the mouth of the messengers of God. And then it says, and his feet as pillars of fire. And he had in his hand a little book open. And he set his right foot upon the sea and his left foot upon the earth. And he cried with a loud voice and as when a lion roareth. And when he had cried, seven thunders uttered their voices. And when the seven thunders had uttered their voices, I was about to write what they said, and he said, and I heard a voice from heaven saying unto me, seal up those things which the seven thunders uttered, and write them not. And the angel which I saw stand upon the sea and upon the earth lifted up his hand to heaven, and swear by him that liveth forever and ever, who created heaven and the things that therein are, and the earth and the things that therein are, and the sea and the things which are therein, that there should be time no longer. But in the days of the voice of the seventh angel, when he shall begin to sound, the mystery of God should be finished.
Absolutely.
As he hath declared to his servants, the prophets.
And the end.
So let me finish. As Paul, so when you went over there and read that, where Paul said he had gave you all of it. No, nobody had gave you all, because the Bible itself is just like I notice a lot of women do it more than men. They buy mystery novels. And they'll talk about they curling up with them that mystery novel and they reading it. And they don't want you to, if you done read it, they don't even want you to tell them who did it. They want to try to figure it out, and it all, if it's a really good one, you don't get the end of it until the end. And the Bible is God's mystery. And if you don't believe it's God's mystery, just look at all of the false religions that's done cropped up from people having misunderstanding of the Bible and making them up a religion. Nobody understood it. But at the last, he said that angel would come, as Jesus called him, the Spirit of Truth,
Jesus,
the Lamb of God. All of those is talking about the same person.
The Lord
that person
said, when
is standing
read,
there talking to you.
Now, the Lord said, minister, when you read, you may understand my knowledge in the mystery of Christ. Be not unwise, but understanding what the Lord, what the will of the Lord is, Ephesians 5 and verse 17. We can understand. That's why we're supposed to read, so we can understand the Scripture. And concerning Revelation chapter 10, when the angel said, time should be no longer, there's a difference between the time of the end and the end of time. The Bible doesn't speak about the end of time here. It speaks about the time of the end. And you want to read about it, and I can't go on in the book of Revelation, but the time of the end comes back when there's a great tribulation period, Daniel chapter 12, 1 and 2. And in Matthew 24, 21, the Bible says, so then there shall be great tribulation, such as was not since the beginning of the world, nor shall ever be. And Jesus said, This generation shall not pass till all these things be fulfilled, Matthew 24:34. Now, I can't spend 2 hours teaching on the book of Revelation, but this is speaking about the mystery of God, which was the revelation of God, which finally came to pass, and the book of Revelation simply refers to the fall of the city of Jerusalem. That's all it has reference to. 1 Corinthians 2, and I'll prove that to you. 1 Corinthians chapter 2. Now, this text has been notoriously misused by denominational preachers, ignorant men who don't look at the context, all right? Now, look, in verse 7 verse 5 of 1 Corinthians 2, he says, that your faith should not stand in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. However, howbeit, we speak wisdom, 1 Corinthians 2:6, among them that are perfect. Yet not the wisdom of this world, nor the princes of this world that have come to naught. We speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, even the hidden wisdom which God ordained before the world unto our glory, which none of the princes of this world knew. For had they known it, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. If they had understood the mystery of God, they wouldn't have crucified him. But now notice verse 9. But as it is written, eye hath not seen, nor ear heard, neither have entered into the heart of man the things which God hath prepared for them that love him. And that's a quotation from Isaiah 64:4. But notice now, please, verse 10. But God hath revealed them unto us by his Spirit. The mysteries have been revealed. And now the mystery is complete. And the mystery is that God brings the Gentiles into the church for full salvation through Jesus Christ. And God sought him out a nation. And that nation is not the new nation of Islam. The nation is the nation of the Gentiles who would perform the mystery of God. Absolutely so. And I can prove that to you if you give me just 5 more minutes, and I'll let you have 20 minutes after that.
And I have to let you have as much time.
All
as
right.
This is your business.
Please. let's look, please, in Matthew 21. Minister thinks that the nation here is the nation of Islam or the world nation, if new nation, world nation. There's a bunch of nations out there that claim that they're the nation. But look at Matthew chapter 21, verse 43. Therefore, I say unto you, the kingdom of God shall be taken from you and given to a nation bringing forth the fruits thereof. And so the kingdom is going to be taken from the Jews and given to another nation. What nation is it? Please look first in Deuteronomy 32. Deuteronomy 32, and then I'm going to let the minister answer after Romans, okay? Deuteronomy 32 and verse 21. Moses said, they have moved me to jealousy with that which is not God. They have provoked me to anger with their vanities, and I will move them to jealousy. With those which are not of people, I will provoke them to anger with a foolish nation. Moses prophesied that his own people would be provoked to anger by a foolish nation. Jesus said the kingdom of God would be taken from them and given to another nation. Now look at Romans chapter 10 and verse 19. Romans 10 and verse 19. And we'll see how the Bible fits wonderfully together. All scripture is given by inspiration of God. Romans 10:19. But I say unto you, did not Israel know? First Moses saith, I will provoke you to jealousy by them that are no people, and by a foolish nation I will anger you. Now look at Romans 11:11. I say then, have they stumbled that they should not fall? God forbid, but rather through their fall salvation is come to the Gentiles, for to provoke to them jealousy. It is the Gentiles. It is all kindreds and colors and people that belong in the kingdom of God. He's not talking about black people or white people. And I love you and I want you saved. And your color of your skin, minister, makes no difference to me. When I was in Atlanta, Georgia, I preached against the KKK. Those cowardly white people that hide behind behind their skirts, I have no fellowship with. I am not a racist. I love my black folk and my white folk all alike. And in fact, it is the Gentiles. Now, you're a Gentile. I'm a Gentile. We all are part of now the kingdom of God. And in Revelation chapter 14, notice the everlasting kingdom doesn't have distinctions. I wouldn't want to be a part of a group who's just got black folk or white folk. Matter of fact, one black lady I converted, 90 years old, she was real light-skinned, and her husband was real dark-skinned. I baptized her, and I said, "Now, Ethel, we got to baptize your husband, too, because you're so light-skinned, they think you're white. We need to get some black people in this church." And in fact, I know it's the right church when, in fact, we have the gospel being preached to every nation. Revelation 14:6. Give me just a moment, and you can have the rest of the time. "I saw another angel fly in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach unto them that dwell on the earth, and to every nation and kindred and tongue and people." The gospel is not for blacks or for whites. It is for all mankind. And anyone who makes some kind of doctrine because someone is black or someone is white, I say is a false teacher. And if there's a white racist out here, repent of your sins. If there's a black racist, repent of your sins. We're all one in Christ. There's neither Jew nor Greek nor bond nor free. You're all one in Christ Jesus. For as many of you as have been baptized into Christ have put on Christ. Now the nation is the Gentiles. Now, minister, you have your time. As a matter of fact, take it right till 5 if you want.
Okay. Thank you. I want to say that when we just read the Word of God and just line upon line and precept on top of precept, we are like children quoting the alphabet. And they think they've did a good job when they, because we praise them. They said, "My baby come in, Daddy, I'd like to say the alphabet for you." And I say, "Yeah, baby, let me hear it." And she go and sang it. And when she get through, I make a big to-do of it, because I know that, you know, that encouragement is something she needs. But when you teach them how to spell, if they hear another child spelling, oftentimes the child that only knows how to sing it or recite it, and the other child says, T-H-E. And the baby that only know the alphabet will say, H don't come after T. You come after T. Because even though they know the alphabet, they don't know its purpose yet. Just like you know the scriptures, people of this world know the scriptures, but they don't know the purpose of them. The purpose of the scriptures is to instruct us in righteousness. The purpose of the scriptures is like you have to do with them. That's what I was told. It says, "Study to show thyself approved unto God," not unto people. It says, "Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth." When we spell our name, just like my given name that my mother named me, Marvin, M-A-R-V-I-N, I rightly divided the alphabet to spell my name. To rightly divide the scripture means to go to one scripture and put it with another scripture in order to show the meaning of what is being said. And that's what I'm here to guide you to. As the scripture tells you, go back to that second chapter of 1 Corinthians there. In the second chapter of 1 Corinthians, it says in the 7th verse, it says, "But we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery." And even the hidden wisdom, which God ordained before the world unto our glory. Now, if it's hidden, then Jesus said this. He said, "The kingdom of heaven is like unto leaven This is the 13th chapter of Matthew. And this is the 33rd verse. Another parable. Well, instead of saying another mystery, he said another parable. But that's what a mystery is in that sense. It's a story that the meaning of it is a mystery. It's a hidden thing. And as Paul said, we speak in mystery. We speak the wisdom of God in a mystery. Jesus spoke in a mystery. His disciples asked him in that same 13th chapter. It says, 10th verse. Pardon me for not waiting on you before. And the disciples came and said unto him, why speakest thou unto them in parables? Are you speaking mysteries to the people? He said, Jesus answered and said unto them, because it is given unto you to know the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven, but to them it is not given. So, I'll show you an example. If I can't go into Jesus' parables and show you the meaning of them, then that would tell you that I ain't the one. It's just like Jesus said he was the door. If what the point of having a front door in your house if a thief can just walk through there whenever he get ready? You need a lock on that door. And the only one that's supposed to be able to get in there got to have a key. You know the key, the word key don't just mean the kind you put in your front door lock. A map has a key to it. And it's right down there at the bottom. And that key is what explains the whole map to a person who knows how to use it. Don't do no good to find the key down there if you don't know what to do with it. So Jesus said, he said in another parable, this is the 33rd verse, another parable spake he unto them. The kingdom of heaven is like unto leaven, which a woman took and hid in 3 measures of meal till the whole was leavened. What is that talking about?
The slow influence of the gospel. I didn't know you were asking a question particularly. Yes. The slow influence of the gospel and how it would permeate the world. Exactly.
No, that's not what that's talking about.
And by the way, I want you to get back before we quit. Okay. Prove you all are the nation of Matthew 21:43.
Okay.
When I said that,
okay,
they were the Gentiles, and I can show you from the Bible they're the Gentiles.
All right, but let me explain this parable here. You've heard the term, David Copperfield, he taught us something about that prefix, leaven. Lev, as in levitate, means to make rise. And the scripture says the kingdom of heaven is like unto leaven. Leaven is yeast. And when you notice anything about yeast, many people don't realize that yeast is a living organism. And it, when you put it in dough, you can put a little yeast in a lot of dough, an ounce of yeast into 15 pounds of dough. And it will, if you mix it in there right and everything, that heavy dough starts to move. It looks like it's alive because it's got something that's alive making it look like that. The word of God is a living word. That's what Jesus was saying. God's word will do to the mind that is in man. Just like, you can't expand what ain't there. But when you got a natural mind in you already, it's like having dough that ain't got no yeast in it. But when you put that word of God in there, it's like adding yeast to it, and all of a sudden you start seeing things in a broader sense. That reap what you sow don't simply mean I'm going to plant some corn and I'm going to get some corn back. You start realizing that every time I do something, I'm sowing something. And if I don't sow the right thing, then whether I know it or not, That's coming back to me, as thou hast done, so shall it be done unto you. And the wonderful thing about Almighty God is that he's a just and merciful God, that if you didn't know what you was doing, he don't hold you totally accountable. He lets you experience a little bit of reaping because you were given little. To whom little is given, only a little is expected. But a man who knows to do better and refuses to do it, he's going to be beaten with many stripes because he knew better. And so this part where it says...
Now, prove to us that...
Now, you told me you were going...
Okay, I want you to get there, though.
Okay.
You have 10 minutes to prove that you guys are the nation.
Okay. The New Jerusalem. If you look at the term Salaam, you will notice that it means peace. The word Jerusalem means founded in peace. When you look at the history of the United States of America, the United States of America is a great nation, the greatest nation that modern civilization has ever really laid eyes on. But the United States of America was not founded in peace. There was a revolutionary war that took place. That Israel over there that calls itself Jerusalem, when they were put over there, they've been fighting ever since. That wasn't founded in peace. But the nation of Islam, you have a definition in the dictionary of Muslim, especially in the modern dictionaries, and it says a member of the nation of Islam. And the nation of Islam that was founded by the Honorable Elijah Muhammad was not founded by bombs and bullets and by rising up against the American government and attacking white people or any other people. It was founded in the teachings of Islam.
Why did Muhammad
cutting me off. Okay. I'm not talking about Muhammad of 1,400 years ago. He's not the author of the Nation of Islam.
Didn't he write the Quran?
I'm talking, the Quran was revealed to Prophet Muhammad, okay. But he didn't write the Quran.
Well, didn't Islam start then?
No, sir. Okay. No, sir. Islam started with God himself. If you look up the definition of Islam, bring it up. And you will see that when you get to the definition of it, it says Arabic, and the meaning of it is submission to the will of God. Islam started with God himself. Submission to his will has always been his religion. It's just like you in your house. In your house, you want people to do what you say or get out. That ain't that a man's home? Finish it. Yeah. You know, just like when you brought up racism. I mean, for instance, I mean, my mere presence here tell you that I ain't think about nobody's color. That ain't got nothing to do with nothing.
I wish that were true.
Well, you wish it was true.
By the way, could a white person repent and become a part of your group?
If I didn't think so, I wouldn't be here talking to you.
So I want that on record, that a white person could repent.
Prophet Muhammad was a white man.
All right. So then how could
Just a moment.
How are white people devils then? Well, you told me in Detroit.
You want me to stand on one foot and explain the history of Islam in 5 minutes.
All right.
What are you doing?
I just hear these things. You seem like a different man than you were in Detroit. You told me I was a devil because I'm a white person.
No, we didn't even get into that.
Yeah, we did.
And no, we didn't. We didn't even get into that
You
teaching.
Said John chapter 8. You said you...
Okay, well, in the 8th chapter of John.
Yes, you did. You
in, the eighth, in the 8th... Well, we didn't have that conversation in no depth.
No, but you told me.
You know, I'm telling you that, for instance, most people, they think... The devil, being the devil, is some kind of insult. But being the devil is not an insult.
Don't think it's much of a compliment.
Just a moment. No, that's because people go by their own understanding instead of what the Word of God says. If you study the history of the devil in the Bible, the Lord, in the book of Job, it says there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord. And it don't say his son Satan, but if the sons came, then and Satan came among them. Satan is called the son of perdition. Yes. And the Lord said a strange thing to Satan. He said, whence comest thou? He didn't say, what are you doing in here? Get out of here. No, he didn't. He asked him, whence comest thou? Where are you coming from? And he said, from going to and fro in the earth and from walking up and down in it. Then the Lord asked Satan a strange question. He said, have you considered my servant Job over there? Kind of remind me of them cartoons where Tom and Jerry was out there. They'd be chasing each other all the movie. I watched cartoons when I was a little boy. And at the end of the cartoon, they shake hands and punch out. Say, I'll see you tomorrow. So if the Lord asks Satan, have you tried my servant Job? What is he telling us he made Satan for?
He didn't make Satan as Satan.
Oh, wait a minute. No. The book said, now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field that the Lord God had made.
Isaiah 14 says he fell.
No. In Isaiah 44. Wait a minute. Just a moment.
Well, now you're making different points.
No. I'm trying to, you ask me these questions, and then when I go to answering them, you cut me off. Would you, but in the 14th chapter of Isaiah, it says, O Lucifer, how art thou fallen from heaven?
Yes.
Thou son of the morning.
Yes.
But you know, what fell, where is this heaven?
John 8:44. Let me show it to you, minister, and then we're going to have to do some questions. But let me just show you where.
Well, who you think it was talking to Jesus?
John 8:44. Please, look.
Yes.
Now notice, all right? And you notice here, he was a murderer from the beginning. You are the father of the devil, the lust of the father you will do. He was a murderer from the beginning. And notice this, and abode not in the truth.
Because
now,
what?
Okay, now, he didn't stay in the truth. He didn't live in the truth. If you have not stayed in the truth.
You told
you
me
to
that this was my
truth.
Turn.
He had to have been with the truth. I had to show you where you're wrong on this.
No, you have that. You're not showing me that I'm wrong.
Right here. This proves it, minister. Right here. Abode not in the truth. In order to stay not, you had to start there.
Well, let me show you. Even right now.
Okay.
Even right now. Without me offering you all salvation as a nation, you left the truth. Look at the homosexuality that's practiced openly in this country and the government condoning.
We'll preach against that.
No, wait a minute. You already, your founding fathers already
Who's
preached
you?
Against
I
that.
Who's you? I came from Germany.
What?
My fathers
everybody
in Germany.
That's in America came from somewhere else.
Last generation, my dad was in Germany.
The
not my
America,
founding fathers.
America is a nation of immigrants.
Yes, but we didn't get here till 40 years ago.
It don't make no difference when we got here.
It doesn't?
We're here. I mean, and we all are citizens of this country.
I tell you, it would make a big difference slave. Now, wait a minute. If you were a slave and you got here when slavery started, and then you came over here on your own after slavery came, it'd make a big difference.
Well, I agree. Well, now you are getting my point. But I agree with that. I mean, the only people that's not in America by choice is my people. But like I said, I got over slavery thanks to the teachings of one man, and that's the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. It's just like when people say, well, you know they call white people devils. Mm-hmm. You know, when Mayor Daley declared Elijah Muhammad Day in Chicago, they questioned him. The press came and questioned him. They said, you declaring Elijah Muhammad Day and Elijah Muhammad teach that white people are devils? You know what Mayor Daley said? If the shoe fits, wear it. Now, all of our lives, it's just like all you, white people ask me this question before. I've heard them pose that question. And when I was in the military, some of the white fellas that I was in the service with, They ask me, hey man, why y'all get mad when white people call you niggas? I hear y'all call each other nigga all the time. And then we say, well, you can't say it as pretty as that ain't no answer. The point is, I heard from white people long before I heard from the Honorable Elijah Muhammad what Allah said about white people. I used to hear white people say, well, speak of the devil. Handsome devil, daredevil, tricky devil. Even call each other bub. What's up, bub? That's one of the names of the devil.
You don't find Christians calling that name brothers.
But
to the devil.
I'm trying to show you a point.
All right, I'm
not gonna let this degenerate into something that it never was the case in the first place. Master Farad Muhammad's mother was a white woman. The one who Allah revealed the truth to us through, his mother was white. And the messenger said, he said that his father was a black man, extremely so. And his mother was a white woman, and he made a good Muslim out of her. Now, if he could make a Muslim out of her, well, that tell me that I'm going to say white people can't be Muslims.
All right.
How am I going to say that any man can't choose to be righteous if he wants
to? Why don't you have white people following
you? Well, I said, what do you think I'm here for? What? You all think right. I just came up here just to put on a show?
No, I don't think that.
No. I want you to, you may think that
I thought
I'm
maybe
just
you just wanted to convert black people.
Now, understand something.
Okay.
I'm not standing up here saying these things because I'm afraid to say something different. I'm standing up here saying this. I'm too old to play games like that. I've been to Vietnam. I done seen all kind of death and all that kind of stuff. I was in Vietnam on my 19th birthday. So ain't too much frightened me now. I mean, most of my life been behind me.
We're not trying to frighten
you,
Mr.
I'm trying to show, no, that's not what I'm suggesting. I'm trying to show you that I'm sincere in what I'm talking about. This is no game with me. I got
people. I'd feel a lot better about it if you had some white people following you. We have black folk in the church.
Okay.
We have Hispanic. I'm married to a Hispanic woman.
I'm not forbidding none of you to accept what I'm teaching. But I know this. Mm. We don't have to live in each other's neighborhood in order to be brethren. I mean, you don't want, if you'd be
yes,
honest.
Yes, I do.
Just a moment.
I want
just
black
a moment.
People.
Just a moment.
I
see,
want
you
black
don't. You don't
folk,
know what I was finna say.
Altogether.
You don't know what I was finna say. If you now, one thing I agree with the Ku Klux Klan on, and that is, if black people and white people keep mixing, there soon will be no white people.
One nation.
Now, just a moment.
One blood.
Just a moment. I've even seen. You look at. The mixing of people.
Like Moses and his wife, an Ethiopian woman?
When you look at the Caucasian race of people, if we mix and go on with each other and finally erase you, we haven't just erased you. We've erased that part of ourselves that was separate, that had a certain wisdom that we can't get no more.
Then why is Jesus the product of a mixed marriage? When Boaz married Ruth, she was a Moabite. It's a
different
race.
Was done in it?
And here we have Jesus coming as a result of a mixed marriage, and he still was the Son of God. I don't care what color you are. And who marries who? I'd rather have two people marry in the faith and out of the race than in the race and out of the faith. Oh, yes.
No,
that's what we teach.
Once you really understand the value of the human family, you won't try to change it. You will try to leave it like it is. Just a moment. I want you to hear something. Now, this ain't something I said.
We're gonna.
Now, I'm not like these other people that you want to say... that you followed somebody, but you contradict the one you follow. I don't contradict the one who
I'm following Jesus. Listen, he's the product of a mixed marriage.
Just a moment. I want you to hear this.
To think these Chicago white people for making it possible for us to obtain the country club. For making it possible for us to get in such position where we can prove ourselves worthy of that position. Yes, sir. We thank them. They have did us a great favor.
Yes, sir.
I don't think that we have nothing to do but to honor and thank them for putting us in such position.
Right. Yes, sir.
Go ahead, Mr. Apostle.
This is their house. And we are here teaching the truth.
Yes, sir.
That's right.
They're not objecting to you teaching the truth. As we have white Muslims in America. And lots of them. We have them all over the world.
Yes, sir.
And they recognize and respect you.
That's right.
Go ahead, Dick.
You must recognize and respect them.
Yes, sir.
You don't disrespect people that is fine to respect you.
Yes, sir.
I remember the last time that I was out to the airport. They let me and my followers get on first.
Yes, sir.
Now, I remember that flag is still flying over America.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Honor and respect the man.
Yes, sir.
Because he still have his flag. That can be interchanged between them and us in that way of respect.
Yes, sir.
We don't have to get up to try to make fun of them just because you have learned yourself and now you have learned them.
Yes, sir.
Just remember,
yes, sir,
that they show you respect after you have ruined yourself.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Show them respect too.
Yes, sir.
Because when you didn't know yourself, you didn't respect self nor anyone else. And them too.
Yes, sir.
Because we didn't know ourselves.
Yes, sir.
But now we respect ourselves and we respect it.
Yes, sir.
Praise be to God.
Yes, sir.
Now, I was just playing that to show you that I ain't playing no game here. I learned it a long time ago in the military that you follow your last orders first. He didn't teach us to go around disrespecting people just because he was teaching us that we are the father of all human beings. You have scientists that tell you that light skin is recessive and dark skin is dominant. Your own scientist, Gregor Mendel, the blue eye is recessive, the brown eye, the black eye is dominant. You get the recessive from the dominant. You don't get the dominant from the recessive. This ain't about being better than nobody. This is about recognizing that we, the human beings on this earth, are a family. And it's time to start acting like one.
Well, I agree with that.
So now you can disagree with your family members, but you don't have to walk around trying to kill them.
I agree with that too. Jesus said, if my kingdom were of this world, would my servants fight for it? So I'm glad we have record that we are not to promote what we believe through physical means. Now, Minister, it is past five.
Okay, let's let the people ask their questions.
We can have the questions. If you have any questions,
you can send them. So I see some of them walking out, so we don't want.
And then you go ahead and read them from there if you have questions. And then we'll both answer. You'll have, tell you what, we're going to have to take a little bit of a time element here. So somebody keep time, 3 minutes to answer. Minister, will you agree to that? We'll
both have three minutes. If I can't keep it to that, I won't even attempt. Y'all go ahead.
All right, we've got 3 minutes.
Better to say nothing than to have say
something.
You can
read them from, Right. Oh, we have to ask on the mic here. That's right. I'll tell you what.
Okay.
I will give the minister half of them. So he can read one and I can read one.
Or you can read them all and
whatever.
You know, it don't make no
difference. You want to read
some? Okay, I'll read some.
Yeah, go ahead. Give him some questions there.
You want to go first?
Yeah.
Okay.
Here is a question. Why did Jesus claim to be Lord and Master in John 13:13-14? So let's just read the text. Would you put that up there for us, please? John 13:13-14. And ye call me Master and Lord, and ye say, well, for so I am, which would be Lord and Master. Very good. If I then, your Lord and Master, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet, for I have given you an example. So my answer to that is that he claimed to be Lord and Master because he's the Lord. In 1 Timothy 6 and verse 15, he's the Lord of lords and the King of kings. As I proved early, he's the Almighty. So he's the Lord and Savior in 2 Peter 2 and verse 20. He's the way, the truth, and the life, John 14 and verse 6. He says, I am the bread of life in John chapter 6. I am the light of the world, John 8 and verse 12. He is the door of the sheepfold, John chapter 10. He is the resurrection and the life of John chapter 11. And so Jesus is the Alpha and the Omega. He's the all in all. And so he is Lord and Master. All right.
Mr. Okay. Master. When Jesus, I was looking for something to share with you on that. In that 13th chapter of John, in verse 13 and 14, if you call me Master and Lord, and ye say, well, for so I am. If I then, your Lord and Master, have washed your feet. You notice he cleared that up. What do you mean? He's telling them he's their Lord. That does not break the scripture. For everyone that a messenger of God comes in contact with in the area where God sent him, he is the Lord of those people. As Moses was the Lord of those who he was sent to. If you didn't obey Moses, you was disobeying God. If you obeyed Moses, you was obeying God. If you obeyed David, you obeyed God. If you didn't obey David, you didn't obey God. Because David was the Lord of the people that he was sent to. But now, over in the 12th chapter of Matthew, it says in the 8th verse, he said, for the Son of Man is Lord, not just of some part. He said the Son of Man is Lord of the Sabbath day. When the Sabbath day come, there ain't going to be but one Lord. That's the Son of Man. That's 8 and 12. That's the 12th chapter and 8th verse. And then in the 100th chapter of Psalms, David chimes in as a choir of angels. That's why it's that song. I like that song about sing choirs of angels. A choir, they all may have a different voice, but they sing in the same words. And so David said, know ye that the Lord, he is God. You see? And Solomon said, trust in the Lord with all your heart. The salvation, Jonah said, salvation is of the Lord. And all of them bore witness to the coming of the Lord. Now, you want me to read the next
question? Well, Matthew, I'm going to respond a little bit to Matthew chapter 12. Thank you, Sam. In verse 8, where Jesus said, for the Son of Man is Lord even of the Sabbath day, he had sent his disciples to eat through the grain fields on the Sabbath day. And the Pharisees said, your disciples are doing which was unlawful to do. And under normal circumstances, that would have been the case. You remember, they were to gather the manna for 6 days. On the seventh day, they were supposed to rest. So why is Jesus allowing the disciples to go through the grain fields on the Sabbath day? And he now speaks about the principle of qualification when it comes to positive law. He says in verse 3, have you not read which David did when he was in hungered, and they were with him, how he entered into the house of God, indeed to eat the showbread, which was not lawful for him to eat, neither for them which were with him, but only for the priest? Or have you not read in the law how that on the Sabbath day the priests in the temple profaned the Sabbath and are blameless? He's speaking about the principle of qualification. We're supposed to forsake not the assembling of ourselves together. But if someone is in a terrible accident, if you're coming to church services, you better stop and take care of that fellow first. And these people were hungry. And so Jesus said that in this place, one is greater than the temple. And if you'd known what this mean, I will have mercy, that is, I will have compassion and not sacrifice. You would have not have condemned the guiltless, for the Son of Man is Lord even of the Sabbath day. That is, he is the true interpreter of the Sabbath day, and that's what the context refers to. Not of some future time of a resting period. He is now speaking specifically about being the Lord of the right to interpret that Sabbath day that the Jews had misinterpreted.
Okay, I'm going to say one more thing on that, and then I'm going
to
leave it alone.
And then you go to the next question.
Jesus told the people, if he thought he was the Son of Man and the Lord of, he wouldn't have told his disciples what he told them in the 17th chapter of Luke. And the let's see here. The 22nd verse. It says, and he said unto the disciples, the days will come when you shall desire to see one of the days of the Son of Man, and you shall not see it. So he wasn't talking about no day of the week. He was talking about the day and time when I would come. And ain't none of them here to see me like you. And if you don't want me, that's you. But you can't say that I didn't come.
Well, the Son of Man, and here's the next question. All the right. Son of Man, which will be slain, resurrected on the third day. And how is it then if you're the Son of Man, why are you not slain and raised again the third day? Jesus said he would be killed and raised again in Matthew 16:21. And Jesus said, remember Matthew 16, whom say ye that I am? And they said, some say John the Baptist, some Elias, some Jeremiah, one of the prophets. But he says to Peter, whom you say that I am? He said, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. And the Christ, who is the Son of Man, is going to be crucified, and he's going to be raised again the third day.
No,
that
sir.
That didn't happen to you.
The book don't say that the Son of Man is Christ. The scripture says that the Son of Man is the Lord God. And it says that he's the head of Christ.
John.
That's what the book says. The head of Christ is God.
God
and
the Father.
David said that the Lord, he is God. And so when you go here and you read these things, you thinking that I'm talking out of the way, but I'm not talking out of the way.
But earlier, minister, in Luke 9, verse 20, he said, but whom say that I am? And Peter answering said, the Christ of God.
And Jesus.
And he straightly charged them, commanded them to tell no man that thing. Why? Because in Matthew 17:9, he says, don't tell anyone the Son of Man is risen until that anyone sees the Son of Man until he is risen from the dead. So when he was risen from the dead, they're supposed to tell everyone that he's the Son of Man, saying the Son of Man must suffer many things, be rejected of the elders and chief priests and scribes, and be slain and raised again
I'm
the third day.
I'm being rejected now. And then
no,
and,
he was rejected.
I'm being rejected by all of the so-called
not
religious.
Not because you're the Son of Man. You're rejected because you're not teaching the truth.
Okay. Well, that's a matter of opinion. But
yes.
When it comes to these things that I'm sharing with you, I'm showing you where I'm getting them from. And if you don't accept it, you have a right to reject it. I'm trying to show people also that we're not just preaching the word, we do the word. As you would men do to you, do that to them.
That's what we're trying to do as well.
I mean, if I want the freedom to disagree with you, what do I have to give you? I mean, common sense. We had the young people, they say, duh. You know, I mean, really.
Well, that's why we're having this debate.
So, let me read one of the questions.
All right, go ahead.
If you are the Son of Man, how did you become the Son of Man? How is it we are not all the Son of Man? That's a good question. I've had many people say, ain't we all the sons of men? All men, ain't they the sons of men? I said, no. I said, all men are the son of a man and a woman. But the scripture calls me the Son of Man. And the messengers of God, it's just like I learned in the school system of America that, man don't all of the time mean an individual man. Sometimes it talks about the whole collective of man. And so all of the prophets collectively were made after the image or imagination of what was in God's mind. And so they were man, so to speak, as the scripture says. God said, let us make man in our image after our likeness. Well, okay. You notice he said our. And that's what goes into the other teaching of the scripture that says that all of those whom the word came to, he called them gods unto whom the word of God came. And so God said, let us make man in our image after our likeness. What is the Bible and the Holy Quran? People say, well, it's full of words. The Bible and the Holy Quran don't have one word in them. All they have are symbols that represent words. But a word can't be seen. And so they said, let us make man in our image after our likeness. So they got together, put the word God sent them and gave them portions. And at every portion that he gave them, they have extract of it here in these scriptures here. And so now God says, now, son of man, take that book and eat it, so that the scripture can be fulfilled. As it is written, it says, for unto which of the angels did he say at any time? He never said it in the gospel. He never said it to Jesus. He never said it to no man.
Lakeshore Church of Christ of Southhaven, Michigan announces a religious debate. Christian versus Muslim. Bible versus Quran. Preacher Holger Neubauer versus the leader and teacher of the new nation of Islam, the Son of Man.
You're watching Power Talk on your community TV station, UHF TV 33, Detroit, Highland Park.
The program does not reflect the views and opinions of Channel 33, its management, or sponsors.
Signs truly did Jesus in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book, but these are written that you might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God. And notice, the Christ.
You remember Jesus told them not to say that to nobody?
Matthew 17:9, minister. Matthew 17:9.
Matthew 24.
Matthew 17:9.
And 5, Jesus said people were going to deceive you telling you that.
No. They were going to be any false Christ would come in his name.
Wait
there.
A minute. No. That's
Matthew 17:9.
Let's go to that. Okay, we'll go to yours first, and then we go to Matthew.
Good. That's a good agreement.
17:9. I figured that would
very
be.
Good. Now notice here, he says, and as they came down from the mountain, Jesus charged them, tell the vision to no man. Notice, you see this word until? Until mm-hmm. the Son of Man be risen again from the dead. Okay. Now who was risen again from the dead?
Me.
Jesus. Who killed you?
I was killed at the beginning of this civilization. I was even taught that I wasn't a black man, I was a Negro. Mm-hmm. I was, my mind was totally killed. That's what the scripture, just a moment. Now you asked the question, let me finish.
All right.
The scripture teaches you, and even the history of Jesus, they tell you Jesus was here 2,000 years ago. Well, the scripture say a day with the Lord is as 1,000 years. Then if Jesus was here 2,000 years ago, then this is the beginning of the 3,000 year, and this is the day that the Son of Man is supposed to be raised.
No, Luke 24. I'll show you where the third day is. Look at Luke 24.
Luke 24.
Now notice verse 1 of Luke 24, and scroll with me now, Scott, okay? All right, look at Luke 24, verse 1. Okay. Now upon the first day of the week, very early in the morning, when they came to the sepulcher, bringing the spices which they had prepared and certain others with them. Now look at verse 7, saying the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men, be crucified, and the third day rise again. Now notice in verse 13, and behold, two of them went the same day unto a village called Emmaus, which was from Jerusalem about 70 furlongs. Now look at verse 21. But we trusted that it had been he should have redeemed Israel. And besides all this, today is the third day since these things were done. Now notice in Christ, in verse 36 beginning, and as they spake, Jesus himself stood in the midst of them, and he said, peace be unto you. Now look at verse 44. And he said unto them, these are the words which I spake unto you while I was yet with you. That
I got
all
a question for you.
Just
go
a
first.
Second here. Must be fulfilled, were written in the law of Moses and in the prophets and the Psalms concerning me, concerning him, Christ. Then opened he their understanding that they might understand the scriptures, and said unto them, thus it is written, and thus it is behooved Christ to suffer and to rise from the dead the third day. It was the third day, that Sunday after the crucifixion of Jesus, that he was raised from the dead.
Now, on that note about crucifying him, but first I want to ask you, how did Jesus say peace be unto you?
How did Jesus say peace be unto you? How did he say it? In love?
In his language.
He said, peace be unto you in love.
No, he said, salam alaikum.
In Arabic?
Well, he said, salam alaikum.
Show me
over
the text.
It's either Hebrew
well,
or Arabic.
First of all,
in the Hebrew, it's shalom alaikum.
All right, so why is that?
I mean, trying to show you.
What difference does that make if I can say peace in the English language?
You remember I told you that all of the prophets were Muslims?
You did tell me that.
Yes.
They were Jews.
That
has
always been the greeting of Muslims ever since the first Muslim. Now, let's get back over here to this
Luke 24. You got to look at Luke 24.
No, okay, let's go to Matthew 24 first.
Well.
You know, remember, I brought that up.
All right.
Now, it says in the 24th and the 4th and 5th verse, and Jesus answered and said unto them, take heed that no man deceive you. For many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. Now, that's plain. Every time from the time I was a little boy, I heard, Father, in Jesus' name. Father, in Jesus' name. We ask these things in Jesus' name. And then you ask them, well, who is Jesus? Jesus is Christ, man. And Jesus said many was going to come in his name, saying he was Christ, and deceive many. I never seen so many people in the world, even in my mama's church, they claim to love Jesus, and they gossip and backbite each other, and people are so, look at the what did Jesus say about love your neighbor as who? And look at all the hooran that all of these people who claim to love Jesus got mad because President Clinton tried it. How many presidents?
We're not
just
going
a minute,
to.
Just a minute. Let's start. No, I didn't cut you off. Now, when President Clinton tried to get national health care, when all of those presidents tried to get all us loving people to say, every American citizen has a right to good health. The preamble to the Constitution says it. It says, we the people of the United States, in order to form a more perfect union, establish justice, promote the general welfare. I think good health is part of promoting general welfare of people. How in the world are we going to produce patriotic citizens when we tell our citizens, I could care less than a tinker's dam about your health, but I want you to go out and put your life on the line to take care of me? It's one thing to want patriotism, but it's another thing to know how to get it. You want people to care about you? You ought to show that you care about people. I'm an expert on robbery, because I grew up being robbed by preachers, robbed by politicians, robbed by, look at the black community. I grew up in poverty. Nobody cared. Projects built all over, and we there killing each other, and the parents dealing drugs, all kind of stuff going on, but a church is on every corner. And a liquor store right across the street. Ain't no sense in getting mad when I'm telling you what you see right outside. Now, what is time to do now is to stop talking, lip profession, and start practicing the righteousness that you claim to believe in.
Well, we're all going to agree with that, Minister. We're talking of whether or not that you are the Son of Man.
What would the Son of Man?
Why don't you deliver national health care to the world?
What would the?
Wait a minute. Why don't you deliver national health care to the United States?
When I'm in the position that the book says I'm going to be in shortly, I am.
Do you give all your people health care in the same way? Do you put
yes,
them on
sir.
All one policy and you
everything,
pay for all of them?
Everything that
I
we.
I hope that you do.
Everything.
Because all tithes are paid to you.
Everything that we have, I share with them. That's how they got that bus out there. I went and got it for them. Did they cost y'all anything, the drug come in?
Y'all paying your tithes to him? Y'all paying your tithes to him? Well, of course, you ought to have plenty then.
Well, we
you
pay
your tithes
just
to
a
me,
moment,
I'll buy
just
you
a
buses.
Moment, just a moment.
I'll buy you two buses.
Just a moment. We pay tithes to the American government. Then why not national health care?
I'm not arguing the
every
rightness.
Time you
look,
walk
look,
in
I'm
the market.
I'm not arguing that. The
every time,
that's a
wait
political
a minute.
Thing.
But you see, you can't open the door and then want to shut it when I come through.
I'm simply saying.
No,
if,
you open the
if
door.
If you're saying that's
you
the criteria, if you're saying that's the criteria.
No, you said that was the criteria. I didn't say that. You asked. You said that if they pay me tithes, I should do that for them. I say, well, I agree with that. Yes, I should. If they're giving me tithes and I'm who I say I am.
Yes.
The scripture says, bring all the tithes into the storehouse that there may be meat in mine house, and test me now herewith, if I will not open up the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing that you don't have room to receive it. They got a bakery and didn't even have a baker. They had an automotive facility that used to be, they got it now, that used to be a dealership. I fixed it up and gave it to them, and they didn't even have nobody that knew how to work on automobiles. I'm doing what I said I would do. I came here to you not trying to condemn you. Ain't none of us been so righteous that we can turn up our nose at nobody.
No, we're trying to try the prophets.
But I'm telling you this. If you give me a chance, I will prove to you that I'm the who I say I am. But if you won't give me the chance to prove it, I mean, you done gave out, they done took. But this government don't even tell you how much money they take from you every day. They ain't never told the American citizens how much tax revenue comes into this government every day.
Well, we're not debating the government.
Well, yes, we are.
No, we're not.
If you're going to judge me, the government's supposed to be on my shoulder. And if you can check me, then you got to check the other governments, too.
The government in the world, you know, the Bible says that give honor to honor is due, tribute to whom tribute is due. Well, Jesus said in Matthew 17 to
It also says that all that ever came before me are thieves and robbers.
When it came to those who were trying to go into it another
I mean, anytime you tell me,
John 10,
anytime you tell me that you're going to take taxes from me, and I learned this from y'all, you're going to take taxes from me and don't give me no say-so in how it's spent? What did they say? Taxation without representation.
That's why we vote for people.
Is what?
That's why we vote for people.
So, no.
Vote
that
them
ain't
out
why,
of office.
Just a moment. Just a moment. They didn't vote the English out of office. They rose up against them and said, we don't want you over us no more. Mm-hmm. And one of the founding fathers, who to England was a terrorist or whatever, he was a patriot to the Americans. He said, now, when they was arguing about breaking away from England, he told him, he said, Patrick Henry, I think that's what his name was. He said, now, I don't know about you, but as for me, give me liberty or give me death. So if that was worth anything, is that a bad example that he set that he was willing to put his life down for his people to live better? Greater love hath no man than this, that he lay down his life for his friend.
And I'm thankful Jesus died for the sins of the world, was buried, and the third day was raised again. 1 Corinthians 15:4-5.
I got a question for you.
Yes.
When you die, do you still have blood pressure?
Yes. Matter of fact, we have a young man here who is a pre-med student. How long does blood pressure, Sam? Are you still here? Where's Sam? How long does the blood pressure last after a man dies? But it can go on after he dies for how long? Up to 8 minutes.
How long you been a doctor, Sam? You say you're not a doctor?
He's a pre-med student.
Well, I ain't never heard no doctor say that your blood pressure's still there when your heart ain't pumping. What creates your blood pressure? What creates blood pressure? Well then, what do you mean after the heart stops beating, there's still pressure? Well, you ain't dead until the heart stops beating. No, sir. No. Official death is when the respiratory system rests, period. When it ceases activity, you are dead.
Well, tell you what, he's attending a med school. If you go to med school and ask those individuals that, but
no,
you're trying
I,
to teach
I've
us
already,
authority.
I've already asked people that have been.
You've been to med school?
I've asked people who have,
well,
doctors.
I'm
and
asking
whatnot.
One who's right now, a student.
Beg your pardon? Okay, I have a daughter in nursing school. When is a person dead? Oh, you talking about clinically dead? I'm not talking about clinically dead.
What do you think?
I'm talking about death.
Look at John 19.
Now we're not going. No. You know why you don't want to talk about that?
Why?
It is because when the soldier stuck Jesus in the side with the spear,
out came blood and water.
It didn't say just out came blood and water. It said, and forthwith.
Yeah.
Forthwith means immediately.
That's right.
That wouldn't happen if the heart wasn't still beating.
Says you. Jesus said he would die and be raised again the third day. 1 Corinthians 15 says he died.
No.
And in
even,
fact, he
even
died.
In the book. Even in the book, the book says that the soldiers came to Jesus and saw that he was dead already, so they break not his legs.
And if there would
have been just a moment
with Jesus, they would have broke his legs. But you know why they didn't break his legs? A Mack truck couldn't have broke his legs because in Psalm 34, not of a bone of him was broken.
I bear witness.
Absolutely.
I bear witness couldn't no Mack truck have broke his legs because they didn't exist. But I'm going to tell you this.
If they did, they couldn't.
I'm going to tell you this. When they broke the legs of the other two,
yes,
it was because them nails in their hands and in their feet and whatever, didn't them, that ain't no vital organs in your hands and your feet. You may be in a lot of pain, but you sure ain't going to die from no nails put in your hands.
The penalty now, of sin is death, both spiritual and physical, and Jesus had the burden of sin, and he ruptured and died. He died, was buried, rose again the third day, 1 Corinthians 15.
That's what you believe.
That's what the Bible says.
Now, the Bible don't say that. The Bible teaches you that what I just told you, that the soldiers came, and when they saw Jesus,
was dead already.
They said they saw the Holy
Quran.
That's
right. You got to see he's
dead.
Wait
a minute. You can't look at nobody and tell if they dead or not.
Absolutely. I tell you what, let's go down to the morgue
is
and
that
I'll
how
tell
they
you
do
everybody
it?
Who's dead.
No. If you go to the morgue, they're supposed to be dead.
All right.
But now, if you look at a person that's laying down, that for instance, someone that has drowned in some ice cold water, mm-hmm, or whatnot, they may appear to be dead to you. Because that has happened before. But they brought them back.
Jesus said he'd be killed.
Just a moment. Now, the reason that you don't want to acknowledge that is because if you acknowledge that, then the whole, and even if you don't, the scriptures does not say that the righteous shall be a ransom for the wicked. The scripture says the wicked shall be a ransom for the righteous.
Matthew 26, verse 28, here says the blood of the New Testament shed for many for the remission of sins. He, in fact, paid the ransom.
Well, by the way, that don't cure sin.
Did you? What's that?
Remission ain't no cure.
Without the shedding of blood, there is no remission. Hebrews 9,
well,
verse 22.
Well, like I said, he couldn't even cure sin. That wasn't to take place until the Son of Man come.
Jesus took away sin when he hung on the cross and said, it is finished.
No.
And the sacrifice was given. And the blood of Jesus was shed.
Well, then if he took away sin, then why is it that Jesus said, I have yet many things to say unto you, but you can't bear them now. Howbeit, when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you
into
all truth.
When the disciples...
And what about this other part?
So we would understand the fullness
of the
mystery of God.
What about this other part over here in the 14th?
By the way, did you know that Muhammad said that Jesus was raised from the dead? Did you know that? Let me read you.
Just a moment.
Oh, no. I want Muhammad to get a word in.
Okay.
Edgewise.
All right.
Muhammad said, chapter 19 in Mary and Jesus,
mm-hmm,
okay? He says, verse 19:33,
mm-hmm,
and peace on the day I was born and the day I die, the day I am raised to life. Such is Jesus, son of Mary, a statement of truth about which they dispute.
Okay.
Muhammad said
that
Jesus was raised to life. Now, those were in the early days of Muhammad when he was in agreement with Christianity.
All right. Now you're talking about the man being raised from physical death. And Jesus already shot that argument down. For Jesus, he was talking with the Pharisees. And they didn't believe in the Sadducees, one of the two. And they didn't believe in the resurrection.
Mm-hmm.
And so they told Jesus, he said, there was a man who had a wife, and he died. And his brother married his wife and to raise up seed to him. And he said, and then he died with childless. And then another brother married her, and all seven of them married her, and they died. And finally, the woman died. And you pulling it up? Finally, the woman died. And they asked Jesus, now, in the resurrection, whose wife is she going to be? And Jesus said, you do err, not knowing the scriptures. For in the resurrection, they neither marry nor are given in marriage. The reason he said that was because the resurrection is a classroom where people are being taught. He said, but as touching the resurrection of the dead, he said, have you not read that Moses showed, what is that? But as touching the resurrection of the dead, have ye not read that which was spoken unto you by God, saying, I am the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. God is not the God of the dead, but of the living.
That's right. See, so in some sense, Abraham was still living. In some sense, Isaac was still living, and Jacob was still living. And so when we die physically, we don't go out of existence. We go somewhere. Remember, Jesus said that the angels came and they took Lazarus to Abraham's bosom. That's what he's saying here.
Go to Ecclesiastes, the 9th chapter.
Oh, boy. This is going to be a good Jehovah's Witness text.
And the fourth and fifth verses, it says, for to him that is joined to all the living, there is hope. For a living dog is better than a dead lion. For the living know that they shall die, but the dead know not anything. Neither have they any more a reward. For the memory of them is forgotten.
One more verse.
Also their love and their hatred and their envy is now perished. Neither have they any more a portion forever in anything that
is done under the sun. Thank you, minister. When you have left Mississippi, you don't know what's going on in Mississippi. And so when you leave this world, you don't know what's going on in the world. And so uncle and aunt so-and-so are not looking down on us, which is the false view in Christendom. It simply says they no longer have view under the sun. And so when we leave
Just a moment.
Okay.
Now, what are you saying?
I'm going to ask you a question. Okay. Go ahead.
What you saying? That we going to go out past Pluto and all that?
I'm saying when we go to the next life, we've got no understanding what's going on in this life.
Show me what the book said, that the dead don't come back.
We find in Luke 16 that Lazarus was carried away by the angels to Abraham's bosom. Answer that one.
Okay, Abraham's bosom is the religion or the doctrine of Abraham.
Abraham's bosom.
Just like...
No, you're wrong.
When they ate
in first century times, they ate at very low-lying tables. So the guest would be close to the host. One would recline this way and one would recline that way. And the guest was very close to the host. He would be close to his chest, close to his bosom. And Lazarus, who was the beggar, and who was full of sores, and had no status and place in this world, was carried away by the angels to Abraham's bosom, and he's the first guest at the table. That's the teaching of Luke 16.
Okay, now let me say this. That might be so.
It is so.
Just a moment. Show Lazarus to you? Show me Jesus. Show me Lazarus. Show me anybody that you say died and came back.
The Bible says, so then faith comes by hearing, and hearing by
the
word
of God. You want to have it both ways. You want to tell people things that you have no proof of. And the scripture says, faith comes by hearing.
And hearing by the word of God?
No, it don't just leave it there. Hearing don't mean a sound. Hearing means, as Jesus said, hear the parable of the sower.
And obey.
When he started explaining it, to his disciples. So what he was really saying is, understand this. And he started explaining it to them. Faith comes by understanding. And if you say that's not so, I tell you what, when a new invention come out, how many of y'all went and bought a microwave as soon as it came out?
Look, these are young people out here.
Don't make no difference. Young or old, don't make no difference. When it first came out, did you trust it?
I don't remember if I did or not.
Yeah, I remember. Them things wasn't going so fast. Because people were saying, I don't know what that thing might be doing to me. And after a while, after they got to know more about the thing, just like the automobile, when it first came out, they say a horseless carriage. They said, that thing ain't going nowhere. The wagon maker said, oh, man, it's a phase. It phased all right. But the point is, you cannot have faith in something that you don't know nothing about.
That's the whole point. God says that there's a better and enduring substance in heaven, Hebrews 10:34. The scripture tells us that there's a better place in heaven. Luke 16:22. It came to pass that the beggar died and was carried by the angels into Abraham's bosom, and the rich man also died and was buried.
Okay, well,
Jesus taught a truth about a series of events, even if Lazarus was not a physical person, but I believe that he was, because it's the only parable that Jesus actually called a man's name. And so here he says, you die and you go to heaven.
Well, actually...
Or you go to the Abraham's bosom, paradise, rather.
Actually, the scripture teaches you who would ascend into heaven. It says, ain't no man ascendeth up to heaven but the one who came down from there.
That's right. And then, for Jesus told the thief on the cross, today thou shalt be with me in paradise.
Until
the judgment of God, the righteous souls remain in paradise, the wicked souls in torment, and then, upon the resurrection day, they'll all come forth and be judged. That's what the scripture teaches.
No, the scripture teaches you that no man ascendeth into heaven but he who
paradise
came.
Paradise is not heaven. Jesus told the thief on the cross, the penitent thief on the cross, today thou
shalt
be
with
me. Are
you purposely cutting me off, or you what?
Luke 23:43.
Now, you said you weren't going to do that. We agreed not to do that.
I had to tell the truth here. You got just a few minutes.
You was telling
if I
your
cut,
own...
I tell you what, did I cut him off?
Yeah, you cut me
off. All right.
Off. You know
well, yeah,
you
okay.
Cut me
yeah,
off.
You say
no,
yeah.
They don't got to say it. Let your own
all
people
right.
tell
you. I'll tell you what. If I did, if I was a bit vituperative, I'd take it back.
Now, I don't know what that word means.
Look
but,
it up. He brought the dictionary.
When people start getting into semantics on you, that's kind of reaching.
I'm not the one.
I got a question here that was asked, and
I
want to
yeah,
answer.
Go ask one more.
It says, "What must I do to be saved?"
Very.
The scripture says. That you must believe on the Son of God, and on His name. And you shall, whosoever believeth on the name and calleth upon the name of the Lord, the same shall be saved. So now, but you got to be repent of your wrong and be retaught. That's what baptism is. Your mind must be retaught the proper understanding, not what the world gave you. Because if what the world gave you was sufficient in righteousness, you wouldn't have needed no spirit of truth to come and guide you into nothing, because you already got it. If somebody got to come and guide you, see, what people don't realize is all the religions of this world is like the scripture says, ain't no more than a filthy rag. Because if someone got to come and guide you into all truth, that means that you are in error. You see? So, and what is the name that you must believe in? It sure ain't Marvin Muhammad.
Isn't that
no,
who you
it's
are?
Not even Son of Man. The scripture says he had a name written that no man knew but he himself. And he was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood. Remember it says, and the word was made flesh and dwelt among us. In order for flesh to live, what you got to keep it dipped in? He was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood. The word was made flesh, and his name is called the Word of God. You want to be saved? You got to believe in the Word of God when it is recited to you in its proper understanding.
Jesus said in John 3 and verse 5, except a man be born of water and of spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. And in fact, the spirit was the agency by which the word was taught. Take the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, Ephesians 6 and verse 17. But the water there is physical water. And we have the example in Acts chapter 8. And we find in verse 35, Philip opened his mouth and began at the same scripture and preached unto him Jesus. And as they went on their way, they came to a certain water, and that's not to a certain word. And the eunuch said, see, here is water. What doth hinder me to be baptized? He didn't say, here's a word. That's not what he said. And Philip said, if thou believest with all thine heart that thou mayest. If thou believest with all thine heart thou mayest. And he answered and said, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. And he commanded the chariot to stand still. And they went both down into the water, and Philip and the eunuch, and he baptized him. Jesus said, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. He that believeth not shall be damned. You must believe in Christ as the Son of God, the Savior of the world. You must repent of every sin. Jesus said, I tell you, nay, except ye repent, ye shall likewise perish. You must make a confession before men. Whosoever confesses me before men, him will I confess before my Father which is in heaven, and you must be baptized. Peter said, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of sins. The Bible says that baptism doth now save us, 1 Peter 3:21. And then be faithful. Be thou faithful unto death, I'll give thee a crown of life. That's the plan of salvation. Everyone must do that in order to be saved.
Now, before I...
got 3 minutes, so make a closing comment.
Before I go, I want to be a good guest, and thank you for allowing me to come in here and speak with you. And I thank you all for having me, Mr. Neubauer.
Yeah, you're welcome.
And let me give you this website so all of you can go and check out what we're doing besides running off at the mouth. It's the New Nation of Islam. .com. The New Nation of Islam.com. We have a conference line that you can sit right in your home. You don't have to come to no special building or nothing to hear us. You can sit right in your living room and listen to us. At every meeting that I have, I put it in that conference room. And it's an interactive line, which means you can unmute your phone and ask your questions or put forth your arguments. And we will respect you to do so. And so that is another scripture that is being fulfilled. It says that if they say he's in the desert, go not forth. If they say he's in the secret chambers, believe it not. For as the lightning cometh out of the east and shineth even unto the west, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. Now you notice, you don't have to go to New York to see the sunrise. You don't have to go to California to see. You stay right where you're at, and the sunrise is so resplendent that no matter where you are, you can see it. And so now that's the way the teachings are. And I don't need no building if I ain't trying to get people together to rob them. You know, you can't pass no collection plate if you're sitting in your living room. So you can hear the truth if that's what you want. I preach from both books, the Holy Bible and the Holy Quran. Okay.
And we'd like to thank again the minister for coming and bringing so many and being so respectful in the audience. Your wonderful audience today. Thank you very much. No cat calls and not too many jostling jokes made, but you all were very respectful, so I appreciate that very much. And again, if
and
you're
so
visiting
your
the community,
members.
You would like to come and visit with Lakeshore Church of Christ. We meet on M140 and County Road 380. We'd like for you to come and to be a part of our services. We simply want to be people of the book, Christians only, and only Christians. And we want to follow Jesus and all of what he's done for us. So thank you for coming. May the Lord reveal all of the truth to you that you need to do, that you need to have in order to be saved. Thank you for coming today.
I see God in every scented rose. I see God everything that grows. I see gold and gentle falling rain in the snow that falls upon the plain. I see gold at sunrise every day in the smile children as they play. I see gold at starlight evening skies in the love that fills a mother's eyes standing above.